everybody. Megan Kramer here, Communications with Kansas Farm Bureau. I have a group of experts here with us today. We're going to try to break down some of the issues that we have heard. So I've got Terry Holdren, CEO of Kansas Farm Bureau.
Hey, everyone. We're glad you're able to join us and listen into this. We're hopeful that these kind of segments will give you some insight into what we are and understand the current market situation of things, but also help you just be better informed about what your farm organization is doing to mitigate and put y'all in the right position.
All right. And we've got President Feltz joining us as well.
Yeah, thank you, Megan. And I want to come at it kind of from the producer perspective that we all know in ag production, we've come off of a very challenging year in 19 and from the production side. And then we dealt with all the trade issues that have been disruptions to pricing, and a lot of optimism going into this year with the trade talks and as they come about, and then all at once we're hammered with something called coronavirus. So it's been a really challenging times for producers, and looking forward to have some information shared with us today. But I think it's also important to remember that farmers probably remain as optimistic as anybody as we go forward.
And then we also have Mark Nelson, who is our Director of Commodities.
Hello, everybody. Can you hear me okay?
And we have Scott Bennett joining us from American Farm Bureau Federation, who is the Director of Congressional Relations.
Hello, everyone. Given the opportunity, we'll break down and what's happening here in Washington amidst this crisis.
Okay, now I'm going to pass it over to Terry if you want to give us just some updates, and then we'll just go around the circle.
Great. Well, thanks, Megan. Again, we appreciate everybody joining today. I'm grateful for the opportunity to share information. We believe that, your farming organization is uniquely positioned in a lot of ways. You can see the folks on the screen today. We're watching closely, and there are more than these folks, obviously, who are watching things in the state capital in Topeka. We're engaged with congressional leaders and with agency folks, both in Topeka and Washington, D.C., to make sure that producers are in the right place. We know that I can see the sun is out in Manhattan today. That means that maybe the rain is stopping across the state of Kansas. And for many of you, that might mean that you're hopeful to get on a tractor with a planter attached to it, put some seed in the ground, but that in order to do that, you may need fertilizer, you may need seed. And so ensuring that those inputs are available to you is an important function that we have, but also then for folks on the other side, that we're doing our best to make sure that inspectors are showing up plants and all of those kinds of things. And so, we're working on all of those angles and wanted to see the information.
Right. Thanks, Terry. I'm going to now hand it over to President Feltz.
Well, there's no question this is challenging times. And as Terry said, we're kind of to the critical point of the year and was out doing a little bit scouting, and when I see ducks and fields that need to be going to plant corn here in the next few weeks, it adds to the challenges that we're already facing. But I think as an organization, we've got to look to the positive side of these things. And we've got to make sure that with all the precautions that are being advised, that we make sure our members adhere to those things. Some of us, I know, we think we're resilient. These things don't happen to us. Sometimes we think we're younger than we are, and we're invincible, but we have to pay attention to a lot of these circumstances and what we do. But yeah, by the same token, we've got to go on with our life too and think about getting crops in the ground for this next year.
So Mark, I'm going to hand it over to you. I know that you've been in contact with some folks and you have a few updates for us.
I tell you, I've been making some phone calls out there, and obviously, you know, by the nature of what we do, you know, we're out in rural parts of the world. And so to an extent, we are already pretty isolated, essentially quarantined. But basically, one of the things I think, you know, things may be going on differently. But really, as far as all the suppliers, et cetera, that I've talked to that are working with producers, things seem like they're pretty much, I don't want to say business as usual, but the supplies, the seed, the fuel, they're going to be there. But I tell you, if you haven't already, I think it's important that we all get on the phone and contact those suppliers. You know, while maybe you've got some seed that needs to be delivered or you need to go pick it up, the way that's done may be a little bit differently. So you want to call ahead, make sure you know. I talked to one elevator who basically said, you know, you can come get your seed, but we'd like you to call. We'll set it out. You can come get it. They're asking people to stay in their trucks when they bring grain, things like that. But otherwise, you know, for a lot of places, it's business as usual. And yeah, we're just waiting for things to dry out a little bit.
All right. Thanks, Mark. And Scott, I know that you guys have been super busy at AFBF. You were on a call with states yesterday and gave us all an update. And you've said even the information you had yesterday has changed. So do you want to kind of go over what you know so far?
Sure. Thanks, Megan. And I come to you from my home office here just outside of Washington. It's unbelievable how the city has essentially shut down. Foot traffic is little to none. There is no meat or fresh vegetables found in the grocery stores. Folks have really pulled the fire alarm here from a social perspective. But we're hard at work at American Farm Bureau, working remotely. But paying close attention to all that is happening with the coronavirus, working closely with USDA and the White House. Fortunately, we have direct communication with both the White House and USDA. But from a livestock perspective, I'll bring you up to speed. I've had direct communication with all of the packers. They are as aware as anyone is the impact that a coronavirus outbreak in any of the plants could have on the industry. Protocols are set in place in order to mitigate that. As far as I know, there has been no employees on the floor of any plants and therefore no disruption there. That is certainly the most important. I'll speak kind of anecdotally, though, some things that I have found interesting. And of course, the cattle markets are as volatile now as they ever have been, and as well as the regular stock market. But there's been about, and again, this is anecdotally, about a 10% reduction in packing plant workforce showing up simply because of the schools being let out and parents having to stay at home with their children. So we have that to battle with as well. We have been in close communication with Ag Marketing Service. We've told them, you know, here we are in these volatile times. We need to make sure that no manipulation is happening by packers or otherwise. They are paying close attention to these livestock markets and ensure us that they are on top of monitoring that situation. We wrote a letter to Secretary Perdue, I believe it went out Monday evening or Tuesday morning, addressing concerns that American Farm Bureau has, in addition to the livestock issues. But by and large, the number one concern there was we need graders in the livestock markets and we need meat inspectors in the packing plants. That's imperative in order to keep the supply chain moving. I know there in Kansas, you all have seen a significant drop in sales at the weekly livestock markets. Here in Virginia, which is where I was born and raised on a cattle operation, the governor has banned all gatherings of 100 or more, and that affects our livestock markets and ability to sell cattle on a weekly basis, not to mention this. We're at the peak of a spring bull sale season in my family, where we would otherwise sell 100 on the 11th of April. We are now having to reassess how we're going to market those cattle. And I'm sure that's the case across Kansas. A few things that I will point that's happening on the Hill. Senator Tom Tillis out of North Carolina and Representative Dusty Johnson of South Dakota led a charge early in the week with a letter to FSIS, essentially Food Safety Inspection Service, that would essentially encourage them to keep those meat inspectors and those graders at the plants and at the livestock markets. There's also been a piece of legislation introduced by Senator Rounds addressing some relief for the livestock markets and cattle producers. We are assessing that legislation now. One thing that we are also advocating for, and we will address this to the White House later this afternoon or tomorrow, is that
cattle producers need, FSA, the Farm Service Agency, needs to work closely with USDA Rural Development and the Small Business Administration on low or no interest loans to cattle producers, just in order for them to stay abreast in the short term as we try and deal with this. One additional thing I'll mention is, fortunately, in the declaration of a national emergency, we've DOT exemption on hours of service for livestock haulers, which has been huge. Again, another cog in the wheel in order to keep this supply chain moving. We see that as a temporary fix, essentially, to our problem. But again, that is something that American Farm Bureau has been lobbying on for years now. I will mention, and I know that there's been a bit of concern among producers, and I have had my phone ring off the hook early in the week when we saw boxed beef prices soar and we saw cattle future prices drop. And I know that that's a concern to many as they look to see, you know, the run on protein at the grocery store. Anecdotally, there are empty shelves at the grocery store with very little protein. Folks are concerned, is that run in demand going to return back to the producer? What I will say is that with that extreme surge in purchasing, essentially families buying in 72 hours the amount of protein that they're going to consume for the next several weeks, the market does not necessarily see coronavirus, but they see that surge in demand. And I think that is largely to contribute for the boxed beef cutout rising the way it did. I will say, too, that in a volatile market, a lot of folks look to the futures market, and we saw those futures prices plummet. We have since seen them rebound to some degree. I think that's just a simple matter of panic in the market, just as we've seen the Dow and the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ bottom out at certain times. Lastly, I'll say that, you know, American agriculture is very resilient. We will get through this. And I know I've seen communities come together in ways that they never have before. I would encourage folks to remain optimistic and know that here in Washington, we are as aware of the short-term needs of our members and livestock producers as we are, still keeping our eye on the ball of our long-term policy goals that we have set here at American Farm Bureau. So with that, I encourage anyone out there to please reach out to me. I can be reached via email at scottb@fb.org. I'd love to hear back from you or hear your anecdotal claims so that we can work to voice your opinions into the things that we are working with the White House and USDA on at this moment. I think it's important to, you know, spring has sprung, right? It's the first day of spring. That's going to happen regardless of whether coronavirus is here or not. I would encourage people to, you know, continue and use the tools that you have available to, you know, hedge your risk, understand that markets are uncertain at this time, and that as we move through the spring, that we certainly hope these markets will rebound from a general perspective as well as in the commodity markets.
You know, obviously prices have been getting hammered, and just as Scott touched on, it's uncertainty, it's fear. We're already starting to see that thing turn around. And I think once all this fear and uncertainty passes, you know, the likelihood that we'll see markets normalize and prices rebound is real high, and we're seeing that already. But it's important to understand that the underlying market fundamentals are going to exert themselves, right? You know, corn export inspections have been running under the level needed to meet current USDA export projections. So that could potentially add to the corn carryout. Ethanol grind is being impacted as we speak. There are plants that are cutting back 25%. Because of less gasoline consumption. So, you know, those are a little bit negative on the corn side. On the beef side, too, steer and heifer dress weights are running 30 pounds higher than a year ago. So we're putting a lot of pounds out there. And on the beef side, too, as the economy slumps, you know, the question is beef going to lose a little bit of market share, maybe to pork and poultry, as this thing extends, you know, 1, 2, 3 months. Now, on the positive side, there's some great things happening on trade, right? We're seeing grain sales emerge, and that's already impacting futures. China is making some big strides in implementing phase one on poultry and beef regulations. And that includes, you know, lifting bird flu bans, lifting barriers on beef growth hormones, cattle over 30 months of age, maximum residue limits, and also maybe more importantly, taking some big steps to certify up to about 500, I think, U.S. beef processing plants, as well as approving a wide variety of beef cuts. And those are the steps that have to be taken to actually get that meat shipped. And that's all big news and good news that's going to really help this market. On the positive side, too, I'd say, you know, we haven't seen disruptions yet in the food processing industry. And I think that's good. The other thing, I guess, from a farm standpoint, you know, to keep ourselves sane, you know, obviously we want to control the things we can, right? You want to prepare for the long haul. We don't know how long this is going to extend, but we hope it's a short haul. Prioritize the safety and sanity of your family, followed closely by the safety of your farm, right? Ensure that family members and your employees understand the most recent COVID-19 mitigation guidance. We want to be aware of who's coming in and out of our farms, right? You may want to consider managing farm access, right? Directing all visitors to come to some centralized location and limiting access to your family and employees. Just some simple things that you can do. And again, obviously you want to get on the phone, contact those suppliers, make sure they have a plan, and make sure, you know, we all know what the process is going to be as things dry out so we get planning.
Terry, I know that we've moved to working off campus. So do you want to hit on some of the things that we're doing state level, and then I'll have President Phelps maybe wrap it up for us. I'm going to unmute you.
As Megan indicated, we have moved to a remote work situation for the state office at Kansas Farm Bureau. Much like American Farm Bureau, we're still engaged and active. Phones are ringing. They'll ring through to employees' cell phones. Email still works. So anybody with a KFB or email address, we're ready to respond and assist. So nothing really should change from that perspective. We made that move out of an abundance of precaution, basically to ensure that our employees who have students who are now out of school, our employees who have family members who might be in those more risky categories from age or health compromised situations, to take care of those folks around them. And we really have encouraged folks, like Mark said, to take the precautions seriously, to isolate, to quarantine, to do all the things that the CDC is recommending, reduce the curve, there it is, of spread of the virus, and we can end up in a better place. I was watching some news this morning and talked to some folks earlier today. The current thought is if we do those things, that, you know, in a 6 to 8 week time frame, we can be coming out of this. That sounds long today, right? But it's short in the overall picture of things. And we can come out of it healthier and without the implications in terms of lives lost and other things that some other countries are seeing. So we really would encourage folks to think about and take seriously the concepts of working remotely, of kind of staying on your farm. There's nothing better for social isolation than a planter, right, on a tractor. So when it dries out, we're in a great spot for that. So we just encourage folks to continue to think about that. We're going to be here. We're looking at tools and resources like this kind of recording that we can get word out to folks. We're also looking at educational resources for kids who might be out of school or teachers who might be looking for lesson plans that can insert an agricultural activity or an agricultural emphasis in that learning component of what schools need to deliver a curriculum at a standard that the state needs. And we're also trying to figure out if there are ways that we can be of service to communities, to our members, to others around us, just to make sure that we're helping folks out in this time that is going to be kind of stressful, right, for folks. And so we want to be available to help mitigate that.
Okay, Rich, I'm going to pass it over to you.
Thank you, Megan, and appreciate the opportunity to get with our membership. I think one thing that is a little bit concerning to me is, as we look at our food supply, and there's no question we have an adequate food supply from the production standpoint to the retail chain. At this point, though, we have not seen any disruptions, as was mentioned earlier, as a result of the coronavirus showing up with employees in any of the chain. That to me, that's a little bit concerning. but we can work through that. I think the big thing, though, that we need to stress to all our people is we all need to control what we control ourselves. Don't be so overwhelmed with things that are out of our control. Do as we're being asked. If they say to have social separation, let's do that. We know that means not going and doing some things that we'd like to do. A lot of people have been discomforted by the same thing. So let's all stay positive. We in ag do a good job at that. This is just another challenge that we never really anticipated we were going to look forward to.
So like Terry mentioned, this is kind of our first installment as we move into this new normal for everybody. We will post this on our social media channels. And so if you have other topics you want to hear about or more information on, just leave us a comment and we will get the information to you. And we appreciate you being a member of Kansas Farm Bureau and American Farm Bureau.